memory. I didn't do anything, yeah. All right, welcome everyone to Salmagundi, one of America's oldest arts organizations, celebrating 150 years this year. My name is Bill Andersky, chair of the curatorial committee, which basically just means I have the distinct honor of hanging all the old stuff. So, Salmagundi's permanent art collection currently numbers about 1,900 works, with approximately 50% oil on canvas and 50% works on paper, as well as about 50 sculpture. We have photography archives containing several hundred works, mostly documentary, and we have several thousand paper documents in the paper archives. We're always accepting financial and art donations. Before we begin, we ask due to COVID, due to the crowd size and COVID, that you keep your mask on during the multimedia talk. Unfortunately, due to COVID, we canceled the reception directly after. I apologize, but I just felt there was too many people to have you take off your mask. For those of you who are comfortable after the lecture, you're invited to patron our gallery, our bar, and our dining room in the lower area where there will be smaller gallery sizes. Salmagundi have been honored to count three of America's greatest puppeteers as members, Tony Sark, Bil Baird, and Peter Baird, Bill's son. Peter was kind enough, after his father's passing, to donate several puppets, as well as his little red piano, in our bar. In this exhibition, we have generous loans from the private collections of Craig Marin, Olga Felgemacher, Noel Barrett, Margaret and David Sullivan, and Jesse and Monty B. And we appreciate that, thank you. Now let's get down to it. So William, or Bill, Britton Baird, was an active and memorable member of the Salmagundi from 1982 until his death in 1987. Baird, who began his career under famous illustrator and originator of the Macy's Parade Balloons, Tony Sark, went on to create more than 3,000 original puppets, participate in more than 400 TV and film productions, as well as write books and perform on Broadway. He is likely best known for his creation of several iconic advertising and early TV show characters, as well as his production of the Lonely Goat Herd puppet show sequence from the 1965 film, The Sound of Music, starring Julie Andrews. Olga Felgemacher spent nearly 10 years with Baird. After the death of Baird's wife and collaborator Cora, a highly talented puppeteer in her own right, Olga starred in every production at the theater, bringing to life characters written for her by such show business luminaries as Sheldon Mayer Harnick and Joe Raposo. After Baird closed up shop, Olga accepted a long-standing invitation with Jim Henson to join his Muppets, where she spent a year on Sesame Street and puppeteered in the first Muppet movie. Felgemacher also, along with her partner and husband, Craig Marin, began their own performing company called Flexitoon, where they design, build, and perform puppets and marionettes for television, film, and stage, including Nickelodeon's Pinwheel, and Shining Time Station, also starring George Carlin and Ringo Starr on PBS. Flexitoon is currently in production with a famous rock band for a wild, immersive puppet theater experience launching fall 2022. And now, let the jamboree begin.
Oh, Jubilee, Come and join the jubilee. This new band swinging in land. Everybody stand. Won't you sing? With a simple sing. Watch the blues go bling. Make the raptors ring. Up to their one jubilee. Carnival of joy. Mr. Bloom won't be about. Music always knocks him out. Sing a song, you can shout and join the jubilee.
Upside down marionettes. There you got it. There's Tony Song working on one of those guys.
Bill on the ladder.
And Bill on the ladder. So Bill was able to really figure out this is what I want to do for my living. And he started doing his own work. And next thing you know, he was working for the WPA. And you can see that right from the beginning, his distinctive style was there on that horse face. That's so new. That's Bill, of course. Horse eats hat. What could that have been about? And then, Orson Welles saw his work. And Orson Welles was putting together the Dr. Faustus, the Seven Deadly Sins. And he hired Bill to make the puppets. And this was fortuitous in so many ways. Not only because Orson Welles became aware of his talent.
That Orson Welles up there with
my but the voices were done by Bill's soon-to-be wife, Cora Bear. So meeting together during the puppet show was kind of like a great way to meet people. Don't you
know? Yeah.
It worked for us. And then when they started their own Bill and Cora Bear Marionette show, they started doing films. This is their first film called Gardening is Fun. And it was in Spanish and talked about using pesticides. How good it was to use pesticides.
And the little bug up here is in the gallery.
Right, that little bug is on display out there. So you can see it. It's one of our favorite puppets. Look how cute that thing is. There he is. And here's the puppets from the Whistling Wizard, Bill and Cora. Highlights of their incredible life. And in front of people and behind it. And here, on the Fred Waring Show, they're doing the story of Carmen, but...
From the bull's point of view.
Oh, he was a rascal. That led to, perhaps, one of the greatest early television puppet shows of all. It was so good, it preempted Lone Ranger. And it was Art Carney meets Peter and the Wolf. Music by Prokofiev and words and lyrics by Ogden Nash. I think parts of it are available on YouTube. It's magnificent. Of course, you have to look, it was done live, so there's a this and that, but still, as soon as I got my VHS, it was in his book too, if you find Bill Baird's book, beautiful spread of how they did this thing live.
This VHS?
You know, I don't think so, yeah. And then, so they were climbing up, and it was always so aspirational. They even had the cover of Life magazine. And
that wolf down there is one of the best puppets. It moves by itself.
That's important, right?
Yeah, it is. It's amazing.
And there's Cora with the rabbit. And there's Peter from Peter and the Wolf and the Hunters. And here's Davy Jones' locker over here. These beautiful, beautiful puppets. And there's Bill with one of the Seven Deadly Sins. I'm not sure which one, but he is standing behind Cora. And this led to a lot of work in advertising. So let's show you two Bill Baird advertising spots from Once Upon a Time. And if there's any children here, this is the kind of stuff your grandparents used to watch. Let's see now. Right here. Bunny Huggers, they're on view out there as well, and they're performed by Frank Sullivan, Bill's co-artistic director. Amazing talent.
And we're here tomorrow with the best KRCA Victor's afternoon high-five solo 45, specially designed for the full-size high-fidelity speaker, to reproduce RCA Victor's fabulous new orthophonic high-fidelity sound, and especially priced too. In fact, it's RCA Victor's lowest-priced high-fidelity phonograph set.
Remember that? Now here comes, this was one of our favorites, absolutely.
And show!
Is it a
show?
Hey, who sneezed? Was it you, Cora?
Not me, Bill.
Did you sneeze?
Not me, Cora.
I'm sure.
Oh, nobody asked me.
Humphrey, you've got a cold.
No, Mr. Baird.
serious diseases, and if you're one of the 8 million hay fever sufferers...
8 million and one!
And one Americans who suffer from hay fever, this booklet is for you.
It was prepared by the Allergy Foundation of America, and it's free. To get your copy,
just write to Sneeze, Box 1005, New York 17, New York. That's Sneeze, Box 1005, New York 17, New York.
Yes, oh yes, when hay fever was the worst thing in the world. What could they do next? I mean, they've conquered everything. Well, how about Max Liebman, the producer from Your Show of Shows with Sid Caesar, said, I'm working with Chrysler. Would you like to put together your own show at the World's Fair? And so in the 64-65 World's Fair, Chrysler Pavilion was the Bil Baird Theater. It was fantastic. It was called the Show-Go-Round. The stage was on a turntable, and every 10 minutes, there was a new audience. It was amazing. I would go on, from Queens, so I would go there and see it and say goodbye to my friends and go back online and see it again. Sit in the first row so maybe I could see the marionette controls. Obsession. You know, and here's Carby Carburetor. It was such a great show.
And they were very nice. You were 12?
Me?
Yeah.
Something like that.
And they were very nice to let him go backstage and watch one of the shows. Several of the shows.
That's absolutely true. Yeah. Just beautiful songs. Cora was so proud.
I was actually kissed by that carburetor. I was called up on the stage.
Really? That's pretty great. Do you have any video?
Yeah.
And then,
Cora wanted to start her own theater. So she started with Orson Welles in live theater, and she loved live theater and wanted to have their own theater. And so they did.
But first, they had to do the big one. And they originally went to the Salzburg Marionettes, who said, pooh.
Movies? Hollywood?
We're not going to do that. So they came to the greatest puppeteer in America, Bil Baird, and they did this scene, and it's probably the quintessential Bil Baird scene. You don't get the bottoms there at the end.
And Bill and Franz Mazakash and Frank Sullivan did all the puppetry, but you think it's the Trapp family.
Wait, it's not? It's not that easy to do.
We saw it last Sunday.
Right. So it was just so beautiful. Every time it comes on, I look to see this. What are we doing here? Get back there, you.
Thank you.
You know, what could they do after that except tour the world? So they worked with the United States State Department, and they toured as goodwill ambassadors. They went to Russia, India, Nepal, Afghanistan, and Turkey. Look at this here. See, Bill's doing Clyde walking along tightrope. There's Sully down there. State-of-the-art speaker. And look at these wonderful people. Look at these wonderful people set up in their courtyard like that. And there, Cora, meet and greet the people. Is that beautiful? And then this one. Look at those kids. Always leave them laughing. That's so beautiful. And then, guess what? It happened. They opened at 59 Barrow Street, the Bil Baird Theater. Bill bought the whole building with the music, with the money from the World's Fair, and they turned it into the most exquisite puppet theater, home, workshop, everything that, well, if Geppetto lived in New York, it would be that. And they planned to open up on with Davy Jones' Locker, which is one of their original shows that they toured with, grand opening December 24th, 1967. They opened, but it wasn't meant to be, because Cora passed away on December 2nd. So she never got a chance to see her dream realized. But Bill carried it on very well, and everyone always sings her praises. But they needed a female puppeteer who was going to step in and play those parts, play the kid parts, play the girl parts, all that stuff. And this is where we kind of connect stories. This was Bill's company in 62-ish, and Foz Fazekas on the left, he went to work on the Muppets and did all the Muppet special effects. Bob Brown's a puppeteer. Carl Harms, big union man, was always Bill's stage designer. Cora, Frank Sully Sullivan, the wonderful Sullivan. George Baird, his baby brother, who he wrapped into doing puppets. And Bill. But then things changed. And in 1971, there was a new company. And that was that one. You see Peter Baird on the right, his son? Yeah. And Patty Blackwood, famous puppeteer who worked for the Croft, Sid and Marty Croft, but also eventually worked Howdy Doody. So there we go. And this is where I think we're going to turn the story over to Olga in Cleveland. Hey, Olga.
I grew up in Cleveland and was fascinated with the theater, the Cleveland Playhouse, which is the oldest repertory theater in the country. I did children's parts there and always snuck into the costume department to see how they were made and bothered the actors and stuff. And I saw Susie Snowflake on television, which was this little flat marionette made with strings, and I fell in love with wanting to make puppets. So of course I did use my dolls.
Oh, yeah, right. Okay.
Strung them up.
I have it.
And made costumes.
Yeah, you also strung up your little sister.
just to see.
Just to see what it's like to control somebody. Is that it, Olga? That's not you, Olga. But there's Olga.
Yeah, and I made the hat. I made one hat out of two hats. I had two hats and put them together.
There you go. Yeah. So she had a headache. And then, you also were dancing, right? You did dancing.
Cleveland was fortunate to have Sergeant Deshin, who had been the artistic director of the Bolshoi, which was the Russian Imperial Ballet in those days, and fled during the Revolution and went to Cleveland, which had a large Russian population, so I was going to be a dancer. Oh, that's Caffarelli Opera Company, and those are two opera singers.
That's all on the right there.
La Traviata.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite pictures, of course. Then you went to college, right? And,
yeah, majored in theater.
Where?
At Northwestern. We had a good theater department, and I got the lead in one of the big university theater productions. But my favorite classes were the lighting design and the costume and the set design, because the acting I had done as a kid.
And you also, so you brought those skills with you to New York City, right? You came to New York to seek
to be in the arts, and be in the theater somehow. And puppets are an amalgam of all of those things, sculpting and costume.
What did you do when you moved to New York?
I got a job at Nickelodeon Marionettes. I first did off-Broadway. I did the Ingenue lead in The Midnight Cry by Wallace Hamilton, and I did
did that went to my feet, a television series, and then a friend of mine invited me to a dress rehearsal, and I walked in to Nickelodeon Marionettes and knew that this is what I was going to do the rest of my life. There were beautiful marionettes hanging there, and I immediately bonded with Vicky Coppola, who ran it, and Patty Blackwood, who also came to work for Bill eventually.
So you worked for Nickelodeon?
I toured the country with Nickelodeon. We did school shows, and
big business marionette bridge. They traveled with the three of them in a bad van, but that's what it was all about. Was doing the shows, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And then you ran into a friend.
Ran into a friend who said that Bil Baird was having auditions, and I'm like, oh, Bil Baird. So I called up and made an appointment, and the day of the audition, I went down in the subway and paid my fare and got on the platform and got scared and went home. And then I was in my apartment thinking, are you crazy? This is really what you want to do. So I got back on the subway and went down to Barrow Street.
And was that it?
Yeah, that's it. That's the Bil Baird theater. Yeah, and stuffed with other young actresses auditioning for to be in the company.
Wow. So what happened? Did you read for Sullivan?
Oh, first you had to read for his artistic director Frank Sullivan, and I passed that part of it.
Bill used to say she has a toy voice.
So it's some of the young women would just leave after that. But I was sent to the second floor.
What is that?
Bill. And to go out on the bridge, you work.
The Marionette Bridge. Bill built this theater on the first floor, and you worked the puppets from the second floor. So you cut a hole all the way through, and you were up there on the second floor working puppets down. And he didn't have a railing.
So and a double bridge.
Double, so you could step across it like that way. It was so formidable. Had to be one of the scariest.
Scary. They auditioned 300 young women, and Frank Rowley, the business manager, told me only about 50 of them were could brave the bridge.
So you never had the job, and that was it.
No, I got the job. I went home.